Again, I'm putting Stank on him.
This week on Backward Compatible, a roundtable discussion about Transistor. Plus, Jim unloads on the troubled launch of Batman Arkham Knight. Doc tries Coup Reformation. And Chris talks tales from the Borderlands. The BackwardCompatible.com podcast starts right now.
Backward Compatible.
Hello, Backward Compatible listeners, and welcome to podcast number 33. As always, I'm Chris, and I'm joined by Jim.
Hey, I'm back this episode.
Yep, and we're joined by Doc.
Hello.
And this week we're going to be doing a bit of discussion on the long-awaited roundtable of Transistor, which we all played through a little while back and have been meaning to do our episode on and just haven't gotten around to it yet for a number of reasons.
Yes.
But we're actually doing it this time. So.
And this was developed by Supergiant Games, right?
Yes.
Am I remembering this right? The same developers from Bastion.
Yes.
Yeah, it's about the guy who dresses up like a nun.
I think that's
exactly
a different game.
Yeah.
Definitely the wrong one.
And we'll get to that. I hope you didn't play
Are you sure that's not Fallout Shelter?
now.
But no.
Let's get this started with some button mosh.
Get ready for the button mosh, where the crew jumps in on the video games they've been rocking lately.
Okay, what have you been playing, Chris?
So I just got done playing Tales from the Borderlands episode.
No, you haven't. Oh, sorry, I'm in mosh mode. Sorry, go ahead.
Yeah, gotcha.
You looked at me like, whoa!
Wait a second.
Did I not?
I'm pretty sure I did. No, but in all seriousness, it was a very good episode. I feel like every time I sort of, quote-unquote, review one of these games after I finish playing it, I sort of just do a quick tweet, basically, with my impressions. And every time, it's basically, it was awesome. So, I mean, I'm getting really redundant at this point, but it was an awesome episode. The writing is really good. They do a great job of kind of maintaining the mood and the humor of the Borderlands series, while also kind of keeping it nice and serious when it needs to be. The character's really awesome. The voice acting is awesome. Everything is awesome, without sounding like the Lego movie a little bit too much.
Too late.
Yeah. That was very intentional, actually.
Then compare it to some of the other, what are they called, story games? The Telltale stuff.
Telltale stuff.
Yeah. Right, yeah, I mean, I know they're technically usually supposed to be called adventure games, but I feel like they're different enough to call them...
Their own mechanic.
Like narrative adventure or something. That. Maybe sounds a little more accurate.
But, I've also been
specifically
playing...
compare it to...
Adventures
like, for example,
are on a rail.
Yeah,
totally on the rail.
But compare it to something like A Wolf Among Us that I know we did a written roundtable episode.
Well, clearly,
Walking Dead.
Clearly
or,
very
or
different
Dead,
tone.
We've talked about.
I get the impression that Tales from the Borderlands has a slightly better production value than The Wolf Among Us. It's probably got a bigger budget, if I had to guess. It's also newer,
that.
So they might have refined their technique a little bit.
Because the art style to me doesn't quite resonate. I haven't played, I haven't played Tales of Borderlands because when I've seen, I'm not really a huge Borderlands fan, which is probably why. But plus, also the art style just doesn't really grab me. And the art style in Wolf Among Us was just so affecting for me.
Yeah.
Like, I loved the way that sort of like the comic lines and
what they do well in Tales from the Borderlands is making it look like Borderlands.
Fair enough.
That being said,
in any
Telltale game, you can actually tell though, like the original Telltale characters have kind of a Telltale look to them.
Yeah.
The artists have a very particular style.
Really?
Then you know, when for instance, in I also been playing Telltale's Game of Thrones. And in there, they actually have cameos from characters from the show. And in those cases, you can tell that they're meant to look like those actors. But then they're also kind of juxtaposed. And they're stylized slightly enough that it doesn't seem too stark a difference. But you can definitely... That's stark, no pun intended.
Wow.
But you can actually see... the difference between the characters are modeled after the actors or in Tales from the Borderlands, their original Borderlands characters, versus the Telltale characters.
Well, they did that with Back to the Future, too.
Yeah.
I mean, you could definitely tell that it was supposed to be Michael J. Fox, which, by the way, it wasn't. I mean, he actually did do, it's like his own grandfather or something. I don't remember exactly what the walk-on was. This was like one line. But the main character who was the Marty character was an impersonator. And he did a brilliant job. Absolutely fantastic voice work.
You can kind of tell the difference, but it's definitely a fantastic impression. I understand why Michael J. Fox. I'm actually a pretty big Michael J. Fox fan.
Yeah, me too.
And just kind of a fan of his career and his life, and you know what he's been through. He's been pretty rough, so I understand why he probably couldn't do the voice acting.
Well, I expect you're right. Yeah.
But
well, believe it or not, even though he still looks like he's 12, he doesn't sound 12 anymore. No. Or I guess 16 would be a better way.
To wasn't Doc voiced by?
Christopher Lloyd?
Thank you.
Yeah, he was.
He was, and that was something that I noticed, just how much older he sounded.
He did sound a little older, yeah.
Really jarring, actually.
Really?
For me, yeah. Because he sounded every bit the, 30 or so years older that he was, and he really, in the earlier movies, he was playing an old man, but he wasn't really that old. And then in these movies, he's basically playing his real age, essentially.
he was supposed to be.
And it just sounded wrong to me.
I mean,
I've watched those movies a billion times, so maybe that's part of it.
That could be,
I also really like Christopher Lloyd, and I just hate the idea of him being old.
Yeah.
So maybe that's part of it, too.
Oh, well, there you go.
Very
old. I like the idea of him being old, because the alternative would be that he's dead.
Well, yeah, but I think that's kind of what it leads up to.
Oh, is, okay.
When you get to this age.
I've got news for you, Jim. You're going to die, too.
Yeah.
But, yeah, no, before, just to kind of wrap up my thoughts on Tales from the Borderlands.
No, we're done with you.
Yeah. Well, this is something...
We're still moshing.
No, but one of the first things I thought when I was playing episode one is this really makes me want to play another tabletop role-playing campaign set in the Borderlands universe, because what it does is kind of shows you the other side of Pandora. It's a side that you hear about a little bit as you're playing through as a Vault Hunter. And technically you still are a Vault Hunter in the sense that you're looking for a vault. But it shows you, you sometimes hear about, the everyday people who live on Pandora, and in this one you actually get to see a good chunk of that. And it really intrigued me to sort of see this other side of this setting and this universe, and so at some point I definitely want to do a not necessarily playing as Vault Hunters campaign tabletop. That could be a lot of fun.
Cool. Cool. Well, I'm going to talk about my gaming experience, because I'm still in mosh mode.
All right.
recently, I've been playing Wolfenstein Old Blood, which is not really a sequel. It's more of an expansion, standalone expansion, or standalone DLC, if we had to call it that now, of Wolfenstein The New Order, which is a game that was the first game we did our roundtable article on. This one actually takes place in the 1940s during World War II. Of course, the conflict is against the Nazis.
Now, would this be before or after, the first chapter of New Order? Because
before.
The first chapter is the final, right? Okay, so it's before that.
Yeah, it's before. Right. And it's all about, raiding Castle Wolfenstein. Essentially, you're on initially a stealth mission, and one of your guys... Well, you both get captured initially, but one of your teammates is... You basically manage to break out. It's actually a pretty neat scene where you have to use, you try to climb a pipe and it breaks apart, and you fall down back into the cell. You're in, this really long, well-type cell. And the pipe broke apart, so now you have this pipe weapon that you can take apart and put back together, and you use it to, open doors, too, and, pull things down.
Oh.
You can use it for,
that's clever.
For
that's
stealth kills. It's very interesting how they use it.
Almost a little bit like the laser Kraftwerk, where it's the customizable weapon that sort of changes over time.
Yeah,
that's quite cool.
It's kind of interesting, and you can take it apart. And you can use both sides of it, sort of like a dual wielding weapon, or you can put it together and it's one big club. And of course, they have a whole bunch of different weapons too. It's pretty robust. It can get pretty hard, especially in the harder difficulty. It's very, very hard. It has a very old school Wolfenstein feel to it, much more so than New Order. It really feels like an old style.
Not really.
Run and gun style FPS that also incorporates the stealth elements that were in New Order and that were also in, of course, Return of Castle Wolfenstein and early Wolfenstein as well. The original Wolfenstein game before Wolfenstein 3D, I'm sure I mentioned it before, but they were stealth games. They were some of the earliest stealth games that have ever been, if not the earliest stealth games ever.
I'm curious to see how that would work, though, because, I remember they had, the dream sequence in the New Order where you could actually play, Escape from Castle Wolfenstein?
No.
Or did not have the same style?
That was Wolfenstein 3D.
Oh, okay.
So, that came after the two that were stealth. The two that were stealth games, actually, first was
Castle. Were they, top-down 2D, sort of?
They were top-down.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
That makes sense.
So, it's very interesting. But, of course, you've played New Order, so you know there are stealth in New Order as well. And you can do the same thing here in Old Blood. Very, very visceral. It's a very intense game, especially in combat when you get found out and you're just... Some of the enemies are very, very brutal. I will say it's definitely the sort of game where if you're not... If you have a problem with violence, if you have a problem with, murdering Nazis pretty horrifically sometimes, maybe it's not the game for you. So it can be a very brutal game, but at the same time, you are... this is war, and you're fighting Nazis, so you now, balance it out however you feel.
There is such a thing as a war crime.
Well, he's not really... These are all, like... Not only, here's the thing about Wolfenstein Nazis. It's something that, that you kind of have to also take keep in mind. Wolfenstein Nazis are not just Nazis. They're super ridiculous, over-the-top, cartoonishly evil Nazis. Like, you know what I'm talking about.
Yeah.
They're all... They're not even just... They're not even like, hey, these guys are Nazis, and they're, like, they're bad. It's more like, no. These are, like... cartoonishly, absurdly evil people.
Caricature.
And they're, yeah, and they're, in, they're, they go out of their way to show that through you in every aspect of the game.
Okay.
The sort of things they do, like the way, like the sort of like way they, you know, torture your character or torture, like, for example, they have this one thing too, which I think is, pretty cool.
Now, are you playing the same protagonist? I forget if you mentioned
BJ.
That.
Yes, BJ, you're playing BJ Blazkowicz.
Mm-hmm.
And there's this one moment. The whole thing is originally you're trying to sneak in as German. So you have this whole scene where you get to see them. Some of the things they're doing, and you're also like a German. You're like a German commander. So you have to walk through, and like there's this Nazi that salutes to you. You have to salute back to him, and there's just, you know, really kind of
like when
he
went to the moon.
Yeah, kind of very interesting. But yeah, it's kind of tough though because you're in this like, you know, Nazi base and some of the stuff they're talking about, and you're like, you have to walk by and salute to this guy. This is very. But anyway, so when you finally save, this is a slight spoiler, but when you finally save the guy you've been looking for, Wesley, he's, you know, been being tortured and his, like, you know, face is all bloody and beaten, and he's been, you know, been electrocuted for a while by this one of the main Nazi guys. And I can't remember the guy's name. Jaeger or something, I want to say. But he has this really big one of those robo dogs. Greta.
Yeah.
Greta, the robo dog. And it's like, you know, this vicious dog. And but you show up there, you see him all tied up, and you think no one's around. They love doing this in Wolfenstein. Because it just works every time. It's like a jump scare, but it works every time on you. So you show up, and like you see Wesley, and you start talking to him, and he starts talking about how, like, he hasn't given up any of the secrets. He's been there for, like, this is like chapter 4, you find him. So it's been a while since you've been in this game, and you still only just now find him. So you know he's been there for, you know, time passage wise, like, it's been a couple of days probably.
Right.
And plus you were in the prison for a while too, so. But yeah, so he does the whole line where, if you remember early on in New Order, where he's about to get, BJ's about to get tortured, and later that's the scene where, like, he has to kill pick one of his guys that dies.
Yeah.
He has a whole scene where he's like, count to four, inhale, count to four, exhale, and it kind of becomes like a theme when he's like dealing with high pressure situations. So he actually, and this is sort of like trying to give you like the origin of that scene, so it has Wesley is the one who tells him that, he gives him, like, that's how he survived the torture. He's able to, like, take himself to another place with that scene.
Interesting.
Because they were friends. He was like the more seasoned guy of the group, even though BJ is, you know, more of like the straight up badass.
Yeah.
Wesley was the more seasoned guy. He was kind of in charge of the mission. So he's kind of like a mentor in a sense. But yeah, of course, naturally, it was a trick, and Jaeger shows up, and he knocks BJ from behind, and he's got him all chained up when you wake up, and you have a little scene where, like, Greta is, like, munching on Wesley. So it's a very sort of brutal scene.
Yeah, yeah.
But yeah, the whole thing, like, it's really great. Like, they have this whole scene where, this will give you an idea of some of, like, the visceral and, like, just, you know, very violent, but also very satisfying, because the way they present these people is, like, just so evil. He's torturing you, trying to get information about, like, the U.S. troop movements and all this stuff, and he takes this one of, I think he takes part of your pipe, the one that has, like, it's been broken, so it's got a sharp edge, and he takes it, and he, like, jams it into your leg as part of his, like, torture, and you're really hurt, and he keeps dipping in for information, and BJ, you know, every time he says, when I get out of here, I'm gonna kill you, and I'm gonna kill your dog, and he's just, like, saying stuff. And then so finally, like, he starts electrocuting you, and BJ's able to, like, reach over and pull the pipe out, so he pulls the pipe piece out of his own leg, and then uses it to, like, bludgeon, to kill Jaeger, and then also uses it to, like, stab Greta.
That's not sanitary.
So, it's a very intense scene.
I don't think they care too much about sanitation.
Which,
at that point.
By the way, you can lose in that scene, which I wanted to see what would happen, because there's a scene where, like, you start getting electrocuted, and I just don't hit square. I see, like, hit square, and I wanted to see how they're going to let me die. They let you die. If you don't hit square to pull the like, pipe out, you die. If you don't hit square to, like, actually stab Jaeger, you die. Or, like, Greta. Greta will kill you if you don't stab Greta.
They must have listened to our podcast then, when we were talking about how we didn't like that nothing happened if you just sat there for too long. Yeah. So
is that the one where Richard was talking about, what is it, the Chicago game, where at the beginning you just sit there forever?
Yeah.
Which one was that?
He
was
Watch Dogs. It was Watch Dogs.
Watch Dogs.
I think he did mention Watch Dogs 6. That was around the time he played it, so that makes sense. Yeah. He did an article on that very early.
Yeah, we also complained about Bioshock Infinite having those moments and that sort of thing.
I could have a whole podcast complaining
about
Bioshock
Infinite. That's a fair criticism, though. Or an unfair criticism, I mean.
Well, Infinite is old.
Oh, Infinite? Yeah. I thought you were talking about Bioshock.
No, I loved Bioshock. Okay. Infinite's the one.
No. Infinite's a fair game.
Stick a pin in it. I'll move on from there. But suffice it to say that I'm actually enjoying Old Blood a lot. Mm. And if you did enjoy New Order, or if you enjoy old style FPSs, or even modern FPSs, or you like stealth, a little bit of stealth in your FPS, I highly recommend it. Oh, or if you like shooting Nazis. Mm-hmm. So if you thought Inglourious Basterds was hot, it was fine cinema, you'll probably... Which, by the way, I didn't really like that movie that much. But this game is great. Mm. So.
Wolfenstein.
Now it's time for Table Talk. Discussions on tabletop games of all kinds.
In my recent string of new games that I am trying, some new to me and others new off the shelf, I went ahead and picked up Coup, and I mentioned that last week, talking about Coup.
And how's that spelled?
C-O-U-P.
That's okay. One of you guys can ask me how something's spelled later.
Yeah, exactly. But the cool thing about it is I went ahead and picked up the expansion, too. Now, if you know the history of Coup, it's actually a Kickstarter game. Hmm. And the expansion, which is called the Resistance?
Reformation.
Reformation, that's right. It's actually really kind of cool because it allows you to play with more players, first of all. Mm. There's more of the same, which in this case is a really good thing, because you have more of the same cards. And then there's a new character which brings into it called the Inquisitor, which actually kind of... you switch it out for the Ambassador. And so it changes the Ambassador ability just a little bit, but then you also have the ability to switch cards with people. And so this is a complete new mechanic where... you may have figured out what my card is, or at least you think you have, but now suddenly I've done the Inquisitor action and I've switched with somebody else. Overlay onto all of this the new faction system, which I think is absolutely fantastic, and suddenly you and I are on the same team, and I can't do bad things to you, you can't do bad things to me, unless I pay to switch your faction, or possibly my faction,
And of course, these are the same factions as the Resistance, where it's like the Resistance versus...
Well, it's red versus blue is what it really comes down to. Yeah. But fun fact, the first edition, it was actually the Catholics versus the Protestants, like straight up, which is really interesting,
Did you mention specifically, because I've kind of picked up the like theme and setting, did you mention it or expand on it a little more?
We talked about it a little bit in our
Last episode.
Yeah, in our mobile minute, because we were actually playing the mobile
adaptation.
Yeah. Okay, that's maybe where I wasn't here for that one.
Yeah, but basically what it comes down to is there's this cool world which they're now calling the
Universe.
Yeah, they're not calling it the Reformation world anymore. They're calling it the Dystopia or Dystopian.
And we were saying that
it should be Dystopia.
Because
right.
Dystopian is an adjective.
Exactly. Yeah. Well, you know, parse grammar. But but the neat thing about it is it's set in the distant future, and basically it allows for lots of different political shenanigans. And that's it. It's just kind of this empty shell for that. Mm. So I guess... In summary, grab Coup, check it out. It's like $12. It's worth it, and it turns a really cool strategy game into a very awesome party game. Mm-hmm. I know we're going to be breaking it out for our 4th of July celebration here. So,
cool. $12?
Yeah, well, for the expansion, yeah.
Oh, okay.
And so the core expansion game itself is like, depending on where
it's
you
like
get
12,
it, it's
15.
Like, yeah, it's like 15.
Oh, wow.
So
what's
really
the name
fantastic.
Of the core game? I'm
Coup.
Sorry. Coup. Oh, that's what you're talking about.
As in coup d'etat.
I see. The core game is Coup, and then the expansion is Restoration.
Right.
Okay. Reformation. Okay. Somewhere along the line, I missed that.
And we were talking about the app, I think it was last week, about the app, and those rules, that rule set with the factions and all that are not yet in the app. I'm looking forward to that. I hope that comes soon. Mm-hmm. That would renew my desire to play on the app. Even more so than the small motivation I have, which is to level up.
Now, actually, one quick question I did have about the Reformation for you. In the rules anywhere, because I know they come with more cards, including just like repeats of the same cards that you had
right.
before. do they say that you're supposed to keep a certain number in the game? Because my understanding is that you're supposed to have only so many so that you can start to deduce
who's bluffing. Well, you know, the normal game, the base game, is for six players, up to six players.
Right.
And you have three cards of each type in the deck. Right. Well, if you're playing with seven or eight, then what you do is you add in another one so that there's four of each type. And if you're playing then with the up to 10 rules, 9 or 10, what you do is you add in so that there's actually five.
Okay. Which they do say that you need to have this many of each kind.
Yes.
In each
version. It's very specific based on the number of players that you're playing.
Gotcha.
So it's kind of important to make sure that you've dealt out the right thing for the right number of players, or else it would all kind of break down because you might not... everybody might not understand that that you can count the cards. And that's part of the game, is counting the cards.
Definitely.
Yeah.
So. Well, I guess... okay, cool. Cool, Doc. I was going to say, at some point I will... It's not in that sort of stage yet, but I do have some friends that are also working on a card game or a variation on a card game that they've been working on. Mm-hmm. So we can talk about that at some point, too. I'm sort of playtesting it.
Mm-hmm.
But, yeah, we'll probably save that for another time when it's a little bit farther along.
Sure. Sounds good.
In development. So get the pen out.
Mm-hmm. Stick a pen in it.
Yeah. I was waiting for Chris to do that.
Yeah, I said stick a pin in it.
Oh, you're right. My bad.
It's the right phrase.
You got it out. And actually, what I should have done is, like, you get the pin out.
All right, let's do some gaming meta.
All right.
I'm ready to bitch.
This is the gaming meta. News and commentary about the games industry and gamer culture.
Okay, so this is something that does always kind of get to me. I really don't like when people just sort of take advantage of others and really just kind of take advantage of the trust that a lot of gamers do have. And I think...
were you hurt this week?
Well, not personally. I guess not really didn't affect me that much, actually. But I was very annoyed because, you know, as a huge Batman fan and as someone that did enjoy Arkham Knight and Arkham City for what they were, I have been excited for... I'm sorry. Arkham Asylum and Arkham City. I got a little ahead of myself for what they were. I have been excited for Arkham Knight. I have seen a lot of the, you know, videos for it, and, you know, it's something that I'd been looking forward to playing. You know, it's something that you can't really play on your PC because the PC version has been removed from Steam, partially because it was completely a broken mess. So, essentially...
They literally removed the game?
Oh, yeah, they removed it from Steam.
Oh, wow.
What happened to those who bought it?
They're able to get it when it re-releases on Steam.
Can they get the refund? We were talking about Steam refunds.
Yes. In fact, they got a lot of Steam refunds.
That's interesting.
And there were a lot of refunds that went through. But, essentially, I am so done with companies releasing a game that is not finished. And then expecting the gamers to be their beta tester. And that's essentially what happened here. Mm-hmm. And what really annoys me about this is that not only is it... Are people putting up with it and are still talking about the parts of the game that do work, despite even on, you know, consoles, issues with frame rates or problems with the Batmobile. I'll get to that in a second, which had so much potential and then failed. But just that issue of putting up with playing a game that is broken and basically being a beta tester, that you're not even, it's not even like you're doing it for free. You're doing it and spending $60 to buy the game. And unfortunately, it's the same thing with pre-orders, too, which is another discussion, too, how pre-orders are essentially allowing companies to do this, because they get all this money from people that buy the game in advance, before they even know if it's a good game, before they bother to play it, before they bother to hear anyone else's reaction. They just immediately think, oh, I'm sure it'll be good, and they give the money in advance. And what happens is the game comes out and is a piece of garbage, and now what are you going to do? You've already bought it. So at least you got Steam refunds, I suppose. But, at least for now. We'll see how long that lasts. But then you also have game journalists, like IGN, which I'm sorry, I'm naming their names, and they suck. IGN, yeah, I don't care, they suck.
Well, you're a game editorialist,
that's
so you can say that.
Well, that's fine.
Call them out.
There we go. Although I'm not even sure that would qualify. I think that's actually a fact, that they suck, at least suck up to WB and companies that pay the money.
I see what you did there.
Yeah, because unfortunately, what they do, not only did they rate this game a broken mess, not only did they rate it a 9.2, but they go out of their way to talk about it. I am active on Twitter. Mm-hmm. I do try to maintain our Twitter account. I also have my own Twitter account, and I'm trying to be somewhat active on social media. So every time I go on there, without fail, and I guess I should not have followed IGN. I just did it because sometimes, you know, sometimes they have actual gaming news.
Mm-hmm.
But not when they're plugging a game, which they clearly were paid by WB or WB Interactive to plug, because every single time it's like they'll mention a game, they'll say something like the last one. It was so obvious. Oh, they had a picture of every time. It's like a picture of Arkham Knight, and then like overlaid on top of it the 9.2 their rating, and they would say something like, "Oh, what games did you guys play this weekend? I bet we don't even have to ask." With the picture of Arkham Knight and the 9.2, it's like, come on, guys, really? Do you think you're saying here? Or like, sorry, Chris, but I'm still in the smut okay. here. Maybe I'm leftover mosh. I don't know. But they're just constantly tweeting about this shit. They're constantly saying, they're saying something like, oh yeah, want to see our impressions on the game? Or like, dude, this game is like the best game of the year and all this. Not for a game that's released a broken mess. And what pisses me off too is that I was reading this that Batman Arkham Knight, despite the you know, I don't know if it counted the Steam refunds or not, but in spite of all these problems with, you know, the basically unplayable PC version, and issues with the Batmobile, I promise I'm getting to that in a minute, it has officially become the best-selling game of the year, outselling Witcher 3 already. And I understand Batman is a huge property. I mean, I love Batman too, as much as the next basically everyone on the other planet. I mean, Batman is extremely popular. I get it. And the first two games were good. I get that. But you get Witcher 3, and it's a game that is very polished upon release. You know, they put a whole bunch of effort into having a whole bunch of content, a whole bunch of different content. They give you all this free stuff when it is released, like the soundtrack, maps, little, you know, booklets and all this. DLC to be released for free.
Yeah.
They didn't have to do any of that. Mm-hmm. They give you all this for the same price as a broken piece of trash. And that's what annoys me, and that's what pisses me off, that they're doing this. Now, just to say a little bit about the Batmobile, then I'll stop my rant, and I'll let y'all jump in here, too. Because it was something that had so much potential, the Batmobile driving around as Batman, and what has got to be one of, if not the coolest cars, or at least car concepts, ever. Mm-hmm. Everyone has their own style of Batmobile, and they're all cool in their own way.
Mm-hmm.
But instead, what we end up getting, instead of, you know, all of the cool different things that you can do, you end up having a lot of these sort of long, drawn-out driving sequences. And I say this, by the way, full disclosure, as someone that has watched, I guess I should have mentioned this for Let's Plays on Arkham Knight, just so I can see what, you know, see what some people are playing, because I refuse to spend any money on this. This, me saying this, is someone that loved the franchise. So essentially, it boils down to either drawn-out chase sequences or tank battles. Like, for example, Deathstroke, who is well-known as being one of the best hand-to-hand combatants in the DC universe. Obviously, Batman is too. So you have this whole possibility of having this great fight using the combat mechanics of the game.
That makes sense.
To defeat Deathstroke. Instead, you battle him. He has his own tank, or, like, vehicle, and Batman's got the Batmobile, and you're like, you know, tank battle bullshit.
Can you not get out and fighting
because like maybe tanks the first game, and then fisticuffs
the
later,
game is or very cinematic in terms of how you approach things, including boss battles.
Oh,
and
really?
That's something that the series is that's always been the one thing about the series that has kind of annoyed me, is how in order to like make you look like Batman when you fight, it's all based on QTE.
Yeah,
so you have to time things, and it does a good job in terms of counters and timing, and there's a lot of things you can do with it, but at the end of the day, it's still kind of doing it for you a little bit. Mm-hmm. I mean, it's still, yes, you're having to press the button, and yes, it's time-based, and you can't just, there's no just auto-win button per se, but it still doesn't feel like you're in complete control of what you're doing.
Mm-hmm.
That's a criticism that I've had since the very beginning. That being said, for those of you that haven't already bought the game, I understand if those of you may have, if you're a huge fan of the series, I would recommend that you don't. Not until WB completely fixes the issues that are wrong with the game. Hey, possibly never, because screw them. I mean, I do think that it's to the point now with all the gamers that have, and there have been plenty that have been bitching about it like me, but I do think that there are quite a few that are just going ahead and taking it, just because there's a lot of gamers that unfortunately are suckers, and they will just take, you know, whatever shit sandwich that someone puts in front of them and just go ahead and eat it. And I think it's getting to the point where I am sick of it, and maybe I'm just venting at this one company for what a lot of other companies have sort of been doing on and off for a while, but it's something that has really annoyed me about AAA developers, and that was one of the things that got me so excited about Witcher 3, because I really do feel, and that's not an American company, maybe that's part of it, I don't know, but that company I really do feel like cares about its consumer base, and cares about, at least at least they have a little bit of dignity in their product. Maybe they don't give a shit about me. I don't know. Mm-hmm. But at least they care about releasing a good product. And they care how that reflects on them. WB doesn't care. They go, you know what? We've got Batman. Mm-hmm. And let me just... And everyone is going to buy a Batman game. And let me say this, to put this out there for anyone that thinks I'm hating on the Rocksteady developers, the people that actually made the game. I'm not, because I'm sure that if it was up to them, they would have a whole other couple of months mm-hmm. to QA this game and get it out in a good state. Yeah. I say this as someone that works in QA, mm-hmm. so I know what that's like, where sometimes you want to have more time to test it and make sure it's right before it goes out. Nope, it's release. It's going. It's mm-hmm. going whether you like it or not.
Yep, yep.
So I don't blame them at all. Mm-hmm. And I know they put a lot of work into it. I do think that they maybe had some missteps with the Batmobile. Maybe that was because they had to push it out more quickly and they couldn't do all the cool stuff that they had shown in the trailer and wanted to do, maybe. Mm-hmm. So that could also be on the publisher as well. But I do think that because of this problem with the publisher that, yeah, I would say hold off your purchase, vote with your dollars, complain about it as much as you possibly can, because as long as we keep letting people get away with this, they're going to keep doing it. Don't pre-order. Also, never pre-order. I don't care what it is. I don't care... the next Zelda, I'm not going to pre-order. Mm-hmm. Don't pre-order. Stop doing it. Because all you're doing is you're giving money to a company before they actually give you something. And especially when these pre-orders that they offer so far in advance, they get all this money so far in advance, you're really just... Like, what's the point? Why should they try to release a quality product if you've already paid them for it?
But how are we going to get our free hat?
Yeah, all this like stupid swag is bullcrap. Besides, Witcher 3 gives it to you for free. Mm. Well, not for free. You pay for the game. But they understand...
I never got a free hat from The Witcher.
I'm not the hat. Sure. You got stickers. You could put them on things.
Yes,
like little wolf stickers.
So post your comments below, and remember, if it's good, one of the crew will respond to it, and if it's bad, Jim will rant about it on the next podcast.
I got a little circular there.
Gonna go back to the IGN thing for a second, though. So yeah, I tried following IGN.
They read everything 9+, don't they?
Yeah, they kind of do. But the one of the points I was going to make, though, is like I stopped following them and Polygon and people like them, and I understand why they do this. Because they're trying to use Twitter as a way to get more clicks on their website, which is ultimately their goal.
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
And, of course, the reason that they do Arkham Knight is because it is controversial right now, and if you do an article about Arkham Knight, it's like, they give them a 9.2, I'm going to click on and see why they said that.
Hold on. Arkham Knight is not controversial in mm-hmm. terms of either the content that is mm-hmm. within it, mm-hmm.
I mean, most controversial that, in that people are complaining about the quality. And stuff
yes,
like
but
that.
They're ignoring that issue.
Mm. Oh yeah,
that's the thing. They're not even going like, oh, but it's still a great game. Mm. They're actually just ignoring it and pretending like there's no problem, even though they're journalists. They're just pretending like it's no. They're journalists again. I'm putting stank on them. They're pretending like they're journalists.
To be fair, they write the reviews before release. Huh? They write the reviews before release, and if they didn't play the PC version, then they might not have known about all those PC versions.
They had access to all versions, and they're continuing to put this out, constantly, like, putting the review out there, ignoring the problem.
Yeah. But I will say, though, just in general, I dislike what IGN does with their tweets, because I don't need to be reminded every 4 hours that there's a review for Batman.
Yeah.
Like, no, I understand they're doing it for people who aren't on Twitter.
But they're not.
So they're trying to get as many.
Let's be clear.
They're going for impressions.
They have clearly been paid by Warner Brothers Interactive to give them not only a high review but to basically advertise their game. Let's be clear, and I can tell you that I know this goes on because my friends are indie game developers that were trying to get their stuff out on different sites. One of them being Kotaku, I remember, who specifically asked them for money. To put it on there, to write an article about it. So this is how these companies get their product out there, is they pay them money. And WB must have paid them a good deal of money, because they're plugging this game like no other I've seen in a long time. Mm. They're really going to town pushing this game.
So
it's marketing.
So what you're saying is...
Game journalists are really game marketers, and that's what people need to understand. Mm. Like, okay, that's why we don't call ourselves journalists. I mean, sometimes we say something related to... We're not really journalists. Mm. And the game journalists are they're not journalists either. They're just marketers, but they call themselves that. Mm. So you can only trust them so far. If they have screenshots and you're hearing one person's opinion about a game, okay. But they're not going to be reporting the story to you, because they get all this free stuff from these companies. Or they get straight up paid by these companies to talk about these games. So of course they're not going to like shoot themselves in the foot and tell you this game's a piece of crap. Mm-hmm. Or even if it's good, they're gonna say, like IGN, if a game is at least, you know, kind of quality or whatever, which Arkham Knight seems to be at least pretty good on console if it works.
If it's decent and it's got Batman,
they're going to give it a 9 plus.
10 out of 10.
Well, it's not necessarily just Batman, just any sort of high profile release.
Yeah,
they're going to give it a 9 plus.
Because they way overhype it for way too long, and then they always give it inevitably the 9 plus score. Yeah.
And it's become worthless.
It's not just IGN, it's a lot of.
Oh, no, I'm picking on IGN because of their constant, you know, just ignoring the PC problems and basically just sticking with the review, not going back and revising it, not having some, like, you know, statements about the problems, and not just basically pretending like they're not there and constantly whoring the game out. Mm-hmm. Let's call it what it is.
So what you're saying, though, ultimately, is this is about ethics and gaming journalism.
This time it really is. And, yeah, of course it is. And
yeah.
What else is it about? I mean, it's bullshit. It pisses me off. As you can probably tell, I do get a little heated about this issue. But I do think that it's something that has been going on for a while with some of these AAA devs.
Yeah, I don't know about... I mean, like, I wouldn't be surprised, but at the same time, I don't know enough to, like, you know, accuse someone of being bribed to do things. But they're definitely...
That's my opinion.
There's definitely, if not bribery, there's definitely, like, a mutually beneficial sort of thing, as we basically give your games thumbs up, and we get all the hits on our website.
Right, yeah, exactly.
People want to see good scores on this game.
Maybe it's just that. Yeah. I mean, I don't know. I can't say for sure. Yeah. But I can say that there's certainly something going on, because when you have such a big issue related to a game where, you know, it's like... gets pulled off of Steam within, what was it, like within hours or something? It was like pretty quickly.
What triggered that?
A ton of people were trying to get refunds immediately, and it basically was like messing the servers up, and WB was like losing money, so they just pulled it off of Steam.
Interesting. Steam didn't make the decision, WB did.
As far as I understand it.
Okay. Mm. Interesting.
Which is interesting, because typically what happens is it's just kind of like... list of known issues, it'll be fixed with the patch in the next couple of days.
Yeah.
But getting pulled off, that's...
Well, because it was unplayable. And I've seen from some people that... And maybe they still had their copy, or maybe it's gone back up. But I've recently, throughout the day... Because, you know, I haven't been able to keep up completely. I work during the day. But I saw some people tweeting about playing on the PC version, just talking about things like still having tons of issues, like frame rate drops and stuff like that. For example, the Batmobile segments tend to be the biggest problems related to that.
Mm-hmm. On a slightly lighter note, I think this actually happened with Arkham Origins as well, but people would joke about, like, how dead people would be in Batman games, like, when you, like, basically break their back or, like, throw them into, like, electrical things. It's like, that's... Batman never kills people, right? So I saw this, like, little webcomic recently where someone's, like, pointing out, like, all the ways that this car is absolutely annihilating people. Like, how could he not be dead? We just ran him over, shot him with your cannon or whatever. And Batman's like, no, I don't kill people. My car, though, he's a psychopath. So.
Yeah, Batman... I mean, it's just something that you have to take with the comics.
Yeah.
It's something that you just have to take with the comics and in that sort of universe, is that, you know, he really beats the living tar out of people, and sometimes you think, yeah, this guy should have just been beaten to death. No, he's not, because he's Batman. You just kind of have to accept... that he's just that good in terms of, like, anatomy and knowing how to
he knows just how far he can go before he kills you.
Yeah. Right. Same thing with, like, getting information out of people. He knows just what to do. It's gonna work because he's Batman.
Yeah.
I think we need to agree that Jim is not allowed to utter the word Batman ever again.
Has he disgraced the name of Batman?
No, I think I just maybe said it one too many times. I said it probably 1,000 times.
I'm actually worried for his health, his blood pressure.
Oh, that's why. Okay.
Yeah, it's personal concern, because, you know, we care about you, sir.
Okay.
We do. We care about you deeply.
So for the rest of the episode, we're not going to mention Batman.
The
B word.
The B word. Yeah.
The other B word.
And we'll move on to our roundtable on Transistor.
Sounds good.
Cool.
All right.
Very different game.
Yeah, very different game. It is set in a city, though.
That's true. It is set in a city. You do play a character.
Yes.
Or is it?
There is a vehicle.
I want to start there, actually.
Oh, you want to start there?
I want to start there because I really don't think that it is set in a city. Mm-hmm. I think that it is, in fact, set inside of a transhuman, let's call it, computer simulation.
The Matrix?
Of sorts.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, no, that makes sense to me. I mean, especially with even the turn-based combat system. Isn't it called, like, turn with parentheses after it?
Yeah.
So
everything's written out like computer functions and code and that sort of stuff.
And they did that. They did that in the Shadowrun games as well, Shadowrun Returns.
Uh-huh.
And
Although in that, you can kind of, like, jack into the system.
Well, that's what I'm saying. So, that's what I was getting to. That's when they do it, is when you're jacked into the system.
Right, right.
And so, like, you don't use attacks. You execute programs. Mm-hmm. But that one's more overt. Mm-hmm. This I kind of agree with you, is that it feels like it could be suggesting that that's actually kind of where you are the whole time. You're in some sort of program.
Yeah. I think that's exactly what's going on.
I think it's either, like, the program idea, which I think is quite likely, or I think it's something where technology is so integrated into human life that everything basically is a program, even though it's still technically, like, you're flesh and blood, but you are plugged into a system.
That doesn't explain the ability to vote on the color of the sky and the weather.
Maybe we just, like, really figured out how to manipulate terraforming or something.
No, I would say that could easily be explained by just living inside a domed city. Like, everything outside has, like, been ruined, and so, like, you know, post-apocalyptic, and they're inside a domed, controlled environment, so they can control the weather and the sky color and all that.
They can sort of build and debuild things and, like, mess with physics and stuff like that.
The nanites come and the bridge is built.
Right. Or it's, like, hard light holograms.
Well, that could be too. Yeah. I'm sticking with my theory, which is that all of them uploaded their consciousness long, long ago.
So it's kind of like the Matrix, but not forced. It's like that we chose to do this because this is the next stage of human existence.
Mm-hmm. I mean, when was that? I guess it was 2013. I went to it was a transhumanism conference, and it was beautiful because one of the very first speakers, he said, "Let's just assume that the transhuman revolution has been successful." Mm. That said, and then he began his thesis, and all of us just kind of went, "Awesome!" and so, that's where I got the whole idea for ficto-personal communication was from that conference, which is one of the essays that we'll be putting up. But this idea of transhumanism, I think, is really popular right now. Mm-hmm. I think it's subtle, but I think it's very pervasive.
I like...
if it can be both of those things.
This game, I mean, it also had, which of course is kind of, I think, it's one of the earlier transhumanist sort of theme or tropes, I guess, in storytelling.
Mm-hmm.
It's the whole, like, cyberpunk games and stories and concepts. And I think that this game sort of has that element to it as well. That sort of, like, I think...
The aesthetic?
I would consider it a cyberpunk game. Yeah. I mean, you are... there is, like, this sort of, like, corporation as ruler kind of concept going on. What were they called? It wasn't the process were the little robot things that you kill. But what was the name of the people that were in charge?
Well, they weren't in charge. They were
like a corporation.
They were like a private organization.
Right. They were essentially in charge because they were so powerful.
They sort of took over.
Right. Yeah. Yeah.
But they weren't in charge really of anything.
But that's how it is with that's my point. That's how it is with Cyberpunk. Because, like, they're not officially in charge, but they have enough power.
I got the impression it was a corporate bordello, that, you know, as a form of government.
I could see that too.
That essentially it was, pure democracy in the sense that everyone gets a vote on the weather, but in another sense that, you know, the pizzas, for example, are being provided by a company, and the company is a subsidiary of the major company, and there's four or five, or maybe just one, company that kind of runs the city, if you will.
Camerata was the name of the
Camerata. That's right, the Camerata. And they're also, they're giving you the news, too, so they're in control of that.
They are.
They're giving you their own spin on what's going on, so you kind of have to, this element of not being sure what to take, what is real and what to take for granted. And I do think, even if you're not inside a computer program, which, my thought was really more along the lines of some sort of, like, controlled environment that is sort of all, like, holodeck-like, where essentially you're executing programs by it's the same sort of thing. Like, you're in control.
That can make sense.
One of the whole points of the transistor itself, which they reveal later in the game, is that it's supposed to be kind of, like, the key.
Mm-hmm. Right.
And so I kind of assumed that it was sort of, like, the key to the program, which is running throughout the entire city. So all of the little tools, all the little things that you're executing in the turn-based gameplay segments, all of those are essentially programs that you're executing with the transistor. You're able to do that with a transistor, which is why,
Let's talk about what the transistor is and what the gameplay is, because I think that all three of us had a different gameplay experience.
Yeah, I mean, the different level of enjoyment maybe with it as well.
Well, I guess first question.
Transistor is a badass sword. Is that all we're getting at? No. It's more than that.
In general, I guess the question I would pose to all of us is, what were our initial, like, our overall impressions of the game? Like, dislike?
Do we not want to save that till the end? Oh, I guess we can talk about that. No, we can talk about that
just
in...
Sort of, just to sort of, like, set the stage for, like, as we keep discussing, did we like the game or not?
I would say I really enjoyed parts of the game, but I didn't enjoy the game overall. Let me say this. In terms of the gameplay, which is a big part of a game, I thought it had a really cool concept. Mm-hmm. I just thought that it was way too easy and way too easy to abuse, mixing and matching your skills. It's way too easy to create combos that would just be devastating. I also think that the learning curve with the bosses was completely wrong. I mean, the boss fights are just completely not what you would... The boss fights are just not using the same sort of skill set that you learned, not so much, from the other enemies. So it just kind of feels very jarring in terms of pace. That being said, once you learn how to, you know, once you kind of learn the boss, or like you really learn bosses in general.
You learn the pattern.
Right. It's still extremely easy.
Yeah.
So it just feels like almost like they don't even want you to care about the gameplay. They want it to just all be the other experience. And the other experiences are great.
Mm-hmm.
You know, the art is fantastic.
Yep, yep.
I love the way that the city is laid out and everything. I love this sort of like crisp, clean, you know, cyberpunk slash future, like near future tech slash, you know environment, science fiction-y, Matrix elements to it. I mean, it's just, I love the aesthetic. The art is great. The music is brilliant. It's Darren Korb again.
Mm-hmm.
So, you know, he's from Bastion, which I love Bastion soundtrack. I don't think this one is quite as good, but maybe that's just because I enjoyed Bastion better as a game. Maybe it just affected me more. Maybe this soundtrack is just as good. I don't know. But it's still great. It's an excellent soundtrack. So, you know, overall, and the narrative that Doc has touched on, I think, for me, the narrative is much stronger in terms of the concept and the world and the lore, and less so in terms of the actual storytelling, the actual presentation of the story. I didn't think was as good. But the way that it is, like, the way they build the world, the way they disseminate information, all this background lore and knowledge, and the way they present all the story, I think is really good. But the actual storytelling part of it, the actual, you know, nuts and bolts, breaking the story apart from all these other experiences, I just don't think is as strong. That's my overall experience.
What about you, Chris?
I thought the game was good overall. I didn't, like, fall in love with it the way, you know... I don't know if I really heard many people who raved about it in general. Like, they would also... Usually the biggest thing that would come out is, the soundtrack's amazing. And, you know,
and it is.
A good game.
It's a really
solid game, and I think it was just the right length. I think if it had gone any longer, I would have started to get tired of it. That being said, I really did like the kind of real-time slash turn-based gameplay. There were parts about that, which we can get into later, that I thought was a little bit weird. But in general, I liked the idea that you can sort of, like, slow down time playing your moves and have, like, this really quick play action sequence.
Yeah.
So it's like you're this, like, really fast action game, and yet you're able to sort of, like, take it step by step, which I think it's really neat.
That actually reminded me of, Fallout.
Not necessarily the VATS system,
although that's a great example, but the precursor to the VATS system, which was... Fallout Tactics, Brotherhood of Steel, which is the unsung, my personal favorite, because it was so squad-based, and it was a tactics game, but it was still done in, you know, in the three-quarter isometric, and it had what was called continuous turn-based. It was the first of the series.
And it's Fallout Tactics, right?
Fallout Tactics, yeah.
Okay. Because I think Brotherhood of Steel is technically, like, this really bad 3D action game on Xbox.
It is, but actually, that was there was a colon.
Brotherhood
of Steel.
I just wanted to make sure that we're talking about
not
the same
game. Not to be confused.
Game.
Yeah, we actually mentioned that last week. This is funny. Not to be confused with the top-down terrible stink burger that was the PS2 horror. But anyway, it was called continuous turn-based, and I haven't really seen that mechanic used quite the same way that it was there, though. Right after that came out, it ended up in a few JRPGs and things like that. Mm-hmm. I mean, even Final Fantasy had kind of a thing where you were waiting for your mana to recharge, and then as soon as you could act.
Yeah, I would say the one that does that the best for me in JRPGs, Grandia.
Grandia
2 does an excellent job at that, and then Grandia Extreme, which was everything except for the combat system was not good. The combat system was excellent.
Mm-hmm.
And then And Grandia 3, of course, is one of my favorite games of all time. And Grandia 2, yeah. 3 had an improved battle system, but, I mean, the story, the characters were not as good.
Sure.
But the combat system, if you're into JRPG, like really good combat systems, it is turn-based, but it's got that real-time element to it. I still think, is yet to be topped in that style.
Really? Wow.
In that style.
Those are strong words.
Yeah. I really do think it's that good.
My question for you guys is, was the turn-based option, which it was, you had to hit a button in order for it to enact.
And you can tell, too, they wanted you basically to pick between playing it real-time and playing it turn-based.
Well, that's my question.
Yeah.
Was it really even an option? Mm-hmm. Or was it, no, this is the way that you play this game? Could you play this game in real-time and win?
Yeah, that's a good question. That's a very good question. I will say that the way I played it was I basically used the jaunt ability. The passive ability, or the secondary ability, I think, actually. Mm-hmm. You plug it in on the secondary slot on one of your abilities, which, actually, I really did like the concept behind building up your gameplay style.
Yeah, me too.
You assign a function to a button, and then you can sort of modify it.
Now, you caught that those were basically the souls of people.
Yes.
Oh, yeah, no, they weren't basically. They straight up seemed they straight up were. I love that.
The concept
was great.
Yeah, the concept was really cool, gameplay-wise. But what I did is I basically used the jaunt ability on kind of my panic button, so to speak. So I would plan out and I'd do all my damage in the turn mode. And then essentially after my turn was over and you're recharging when you can't do anything, the jaunt ability actually lets you use that one ability outside while you're recharging. And so basically what I would do is I would... do my damage, and then while I'm basically waiting for it to recharge, I would run, hide, and if I had to, I would attack someone, basically melee, using that one ability that I could use outside. That being said, I would have liked to have seen a way for me to be able to use more stuff outside, even if I'm not as effective as I would be in turn. I just really do think that they basically want you to pick what's your play style. Are you turn-based, or are you live action?
Yeah.
And there are definitely some times when you have to go turn. I will say that, because things happen so quick, and you have to, like, you know, sort of counter something in slow motion, or you have to, like, get in front of something, or whatever the case might be, where, like, you know, even if you do want to play it live, real-time, live action, you're definitely going to have to use the turn at least sometimes as a mechanic.
Mm-hmm. So you basically did a good mixture back and forth?
I did mostly turn, and then when I could, like I said, it was my panic button. It was, if an enemy's about to attack me, I can hit them and knock them back a little bit until I'm recharged.
Because I know for me, I focused pretty much exclusively on turn-based. Mm-hmm. I did some, played around a little bit with the real-time combat, but I didn't feel like it was strong enough.
Mm-hmm. There were too many bonuses, many buffs from being in turn-based.
That's why I thought it was just too easy to abuse, and it kind of disappointed me, because that was something that I thought was really strong in Bastion. I loved the real-time battles in Bastion. And I thought it was, the way they did it, they handled it so well.
And I think the way they try to balance it, and this is kind of going back to my point about not being able to use abilities while you're recharging, is that basically the punishment for using turn is just you have to wait 5 seconds.
Yeah.
And so basically you have to plan to put yourself in the best position, but I don't like the idea that the player has to be passive for so long in order to then be able to act again.
Yeah, that was unfortunate. Mm-hmm. You know, it's funny though, because my playstyle was... almost completely different than yours, Chris. Mm. And that by the time I got to the end, I just buffed my health, created a shield for myself, and then gave myself the speed ability so it recharged faster. Mm-hmm. So I didn't have to wait the 5 seconds. I only had to wait 3.
Right.
So then it was about going in, attacking hard, running away. Mm-hmm. Going in, attacking hard, running away.
Yeah.
That was it for me. I mean, it's just and rinse, repeat.
I was very similar to that in a lot of ways.
Oh, were you?
Okay. Yeah. Except that I did have the panic button outside of
right.
Although that being said, I did totally recalibrate for the final boss, which I thought was interesting, because the first time you face the final boss, it's like prepare yourself and they totally wipe and reset your abilities.
Uh-huh.
But it's like
that
if you haven't played it before, like if you've played it before, you know what you have to change. But if you haven't played it before, it's like, okay, I'll just do the same thing I did before, and you realize why that's wrong, and then you go and do it. And so, like, they have the concept of recursion. They call a new game plus recursion, you know?
Yeah.
So I think the idea is that you're supposed to replay it, and it's a short enough game that I think it was designed for replay, in the sense that, like, you're trying to find your ultimate build, and you're trying to keep leveling yourself up, and you can't really be fully powered up until at least, like, you know, your second playthrough.
Sure, yeah.
So it seems like they really are encouraging you to keep replaying.
That sounds
sad. Sad thing is, I didn't find it so appealing that, like, I mean, at least not right away. I might go back and play it again at some point. Mm-hmm. But I didn't, like, want to jump right into, yes, let's do Recursion. This is awesome. You know, it was like, no, I might come back to it.
Yeah, I agree.
I didn't even play. I didn't even finish it, to be honest. Mm. Gotta be completely honest.
Why didn't you finish it?
Because I just didn't feel engaged enough by the combat. In fact, I probably would have...
So it was the combat, not the story?
No, I liked the story. Well, I liked... Like I said, I think the way that the narrative was presented, the actual storytelling, could have been better, but I liked the concept so much, and yeah, I loved the world, and the lore, and, like, yeah, the way the world was built, I thought the world building was so strong, mm-hmm. and I thought that all this little background stuff, all the cool things, like, you're going and you're, like, voting on weather, all that kind of stuff was just mm-hmm. done so well, and of course the music was just incredible, so it wasn't anything related to that, it was just, the gameplay itself, I felt it was just... I felt like I was just almost like I was cheating because it was just so easy to abuse everything, and the only thing that I ever felt anything in terms of like a challenge were on initially in early boss fights, because you know if I hadn't figured out the pattern initially there was, because it's so different from the rest of the combat, mm-hmm. so like I'm basically in sleep mode doing the combat practice, I'm not even trying, it's so easy to get through it, and then I go to the boss and suddenly it's like totally different, so it's sort of like it actually was more frustrating than challenging. But then once I figured out that part, too, it really wasn't hard either. Mm-hmm. The boss fight, the way you're explaining it, sounds like that would have just really pissed me off. I didn't quite get there. I got really far in mm-hmm. the game, but I didn't quite get there. And honestly, I probably would have quit sooner if we hadn't been, you know, hadn't done this roundtable. Mm-hmm. I tried to force myself to power through. I got to a certain point. And I'm like, it's just not going to happen. I just don't want
yeah.
to.
Yeah.
So that was my thing. I mean, I think... I've gone back and I've watched some Let's Plays, and I've seen... Not Let's Plays. I actually watched them just straight up, you know... playthroughs, I should say, because they're not talking over anything. So, because I don't want them to. I want to hear the music. Mm-hmm. So I have seen more of the game, and I do kind of know how the story goes, and so all of that. But, because I wanted to, I kind of wanted to see where it ended up. I really wish the gameplay was stronger, because I feel like that's a pretty big flaw in a game that did so many other things right.
My biggest criticism was the acting.
Really?
Yep.
I could see that too, actually. That's true, because some of the... You mean specifically the voice acting.
Well, the voice acting, yes. I think
so
that...
obviously they do the same thing as Bastion, where you've got basically a chatterbox character who's narrating the gameplay.
And his deadpan monotone, mm-hmm. I actually found highly irritating. Mm. But I could have dealt with that if he was, in fact, a computer program or something like that. You know, maybe he was a clever AI. Mm-hmm. And we don't really find out until later... the strong suggestion, and I don't think they even really resolve it. Maybe they do, but they certainly didn't make it clear. Mm. If it was a love story, the love
it
was completely.
Actually, I thought that was pretty clear.
Yeah, I thought so too.
Was it?
Yeah. I thought so too. I watched part of the end of it, but yeah, no, I thought it was pretty clear.
I played through the whole thing, but I mean,
the guy gets stabbed, and then he becomes in part of the sword, right? And then at the end, she stabbed herself.
Well, and if there was nothing,
then they're together, and they have this whole like.
Yeah, if you didn't know before the end credits definitely confirm.
Yeah, it's
that
pretty.
They were in a relationship well before
but
the events
of weak.
The game.
I think it was completely.
No, I completely agree with you.
And part of that too is that your main character was mute.
And what I'm saying, no, that's very true.
But not. But that's so that at the end she could like speak, and that's supposed to be
and
this
say,
great
hey.
Moment.
Yeah. I guess what I'm saying is I honestly, after playing it, don't know whether or not it was bad writing or bad delivery or both. And that's really what it comes down to for me. Whenever I was accessing terminals and members of the Camerata were coming on and saying, well, we did this thing and it was this and da da da, I really got the impression that within the context of what I was saying before, that these are all transhumans that have been in the system for, let's call it 1,000 years, that they are so bored out of their minds that not a single one of them can express human emotion anymore. That's where I came from at that point, was that...
I kind of agree with
all
that.
All of them are dead inside.
Yeah,
every
I agree
single
with that
one
too,
of them
actually.
Just completely dead inside. And that's why all the lines were delivered.
I got the impression, too, even for things like the characters or the souls that you would interact with, that was the impression I got with them, too.
Yeah.
I felt like that about basically every character in the game.
Yeah. So, I mean, the world building was fantastic, but I think that the direction that they went with in tone... Mm-hmm. With the writing and the delivery, I think was way off base. There could have been so much more there, and I think that's where Bastion shines, is that you've got this apocalyptic, almost happy-go-lucky apocalyptic world, and you've got to make that decision in Bastion, do I reform the world or do I let it be? And it's a meaningful decision. Mm-hmm. If that decision had come up in Transistor, it wouldn't have been meaningful.
Yeah,
I agree. I mean, instead what you get is, should I build this bridge? and you have to.
And plus, you've got. I mean, I do think the characters were much stronger in Bastion too.
Yeah,
you
know, they were.
You had that whole element of also the like. I can't remember his name, but like one of the enemy characters, and you could save him at the end.
Mm-hmm.
Or you could just leave him there to die, and like it's a really. The whole ending sequence is totally different depending on what choice that you make.
Yeah.
And it's really interesting. I mean, I'm just talking about it and remembering I'm getting goosebumps. That's how like affecting I think it was
right.
for me. But I didn't get that in Transistor.
No.
So, and that's why I say that I might be a little bit too harsh on the soundtrack. I mean, and of course I have said it's fantastic, but when I said that it's just not as good as the Bastion soundtrack, and maybe that's just because I associate that with a better experience.
An overall emotional reaction. Yeah.
Right. Yeah.
And I think you may be right there. You know, we should do a whole episode on soundtracks. That would be awesome.
Yeah, maybe we can do that sometime soon.
Maybe something related to music.
Yeah. But no, I did want to talk on that note about the presentation and kind of the issues that I had with it.
Mm-hmm.
And I will preface this by saying that, again, we've talked about the aesthetic, the soundtrack, all excellent. And overall, I did appreciate, even if, and I'm going to get into why I didn't quite love it, I did appreciate what they were doing as far as kind of like the seamless presentation of, basically, you almost never stop for cutscenes. Like, any time that you're not in control, there's usually something happening, and it's pretty quick. But I had this issue where, and this is almost more of like a blanket criticism of, we'll say games criticism,
mm-hmm.
Where you have all these gamers who
start
nitpicking about things like, you know, not liking cutscenes and how like the game like stops and goes because of stuff like that, and how you know, you need to, you know, show and not tell and all this different stuff, and
people
go on and on about you know, player choice and the game can't be too linear, you need to let the player sort of customize their experience and all this different stuff. It basically sounds like what they did is came up with a checklist of things that people hate in games,
mm-hmm.
and basically said, how can we fix all these? And it was a valiant effort. I really do think that it's a step in the right direction. But there are also some problems where I found myself finding, like, I found myself wanting some of this stuff. Not for it to be completely removed. Like, you know, for example, the story, you sort of, like, come in media res, and of course they have, like, they're like, oh, she's pulling a sword out of someone, what's behind all that? You know, but that didn't really catch me.
And the first line is really compelling.
We're not going to get away with this, are we?
Yeah, exactly.
And so it's like, you know, they're trying to like set up this mystery. And so what they're trying to do is this slow reveal of information. And so people always say, it's like, when I'm playing a game, I want to learn more about the worlds I play.
Uh-huh.
I want to know a little bit about the world to start, though. I don't want to just be dropped right into it and have to learn everything their gameplay, because I feel like to relate to my character and to have agency, I need to be motivated.
Mm.
I need to know why my character's doing what they're doing. And they even say, too, in the game, like, oh, they took your voice away, they're going to pay for this, that sort of thing.
Mm-hmm.
Why was my voice so important to me? You read later, it's because you were a singer and all this different
right.
stuff. But I want to see the world before it goes to hell, so that I know when it goes to hell why it's bad that it went to hell. If that makes sense.
Well,
you're talking about a metaphorical world when you say world go to hell, right?
Yes. Yeah.
but if you
not
look,
necessarily the world.
Yeah.
If you look at the evidence, you know. I mean, let's use a different example. Enslaved, Odyssey to the West. You never see the world before the apocalypse happens. What you see is an absolutely beautiful apocalypse, and it's gorgeous, and these old rusty robots. And you also see signs, and on the signs it says, you know, buy your security robot today.
Mm-hmm.
And you know that these things turned. At some point, something went terribly wrong. And you can piece all of that together.
Yeah. And
it's super fun to be able to do that.
Yeah, and I do sort of appreciate when that happens. The thing that I think kind of bugged me about this one is that everything you learn about the world is piecemeal, and it feels like there's actually really important stuff that you need to know, whereas with the apocalyptic thing, it's like, you know, these characters have their own problems, and they're kind of like, you know, doing your thing. You're fighting against some sort of big conspiracy, great evil, whatever it is,
but you don't know anything about.
Yeah. And
okay.
And in a way, it's like, you know, that there is a little bit of, there's a term I'm looking for, but we'll call it agency for now.
Mm-hmm.
That, like, you know, you as the player, just like the character doesn't know everything that's going on, and you have to learn this yourself.
Right.
But, like, why do I dislike the Camarada? It turns out they've actually been on the rise and pestering you for a while now, and they've been a problem for a while now, but all you really get is just glimpses kind of a background stuff. And while by the end of the game I do understand what the story is supposed to be, it wasn't as impactful as some other narrative presentations have been for me. Maybe this is just me. Maybe I just have a different taste than some people.
But I think, yeah, I mean, the way the narrative was presented, I mean, I do think the storytelling itself, that was my problem with it, too. Mm-hmm. I don't necessarily agree that, you know, I do think that in terms of, like, revealing more, that kind of thing, I do think that that extra mystery was one of the things that actually kind of kept me going a little bit longer.
Mm-hmm.
I sort of, like, not really sure what it's all about, the way the world was put together. But I do think they took it too far. I think that was the problem. Mm-hmm. Is that, like, they had moments to drop more information at you, and not, I'm not talking like an info dump, but they could have done a better job of disseminating information in a way that helps you feel like you're involved in the story and you're learning as you go.
Yeah.
Which I just think they kind of failed at that.
I also feel like there were kind of some moments of disparate tone when, if the entire thing was, as you said, kind of deadpan. Mm-hmm. Like, actually, I didn't mind the tone. The delivery, it was not, you know, the greatest, but I didn't mind it.
Mm-hmm.
But that being said, there were moments when, like, you know, you'd go to Red's house and you'd eat pizza, and she's all smiley, and it's just like, you know, you hanging out. It's like this nice quiet moment with you and your sword. But we never see that side of her outside of, like, these two scenes where you, like, have, like, this little respite.
Yeah. Right.
And so it's like, right. Red hasn't come across to me at all as being, like, fun-loving and cheerful and all that sort of stuff.
Right.
Because it's all just been fighting in, like, you know, three-quarter view all the way down here, and of course she has no dialogue. So, like, you know, even if there was a past, it doesn't seem like she'd be in a good mood at all right now.
Mm-hmm.
So why are we having kind of like these sort of like cutesy, almost like fan art moments?
That's what it came across.
That's what it came across to me as. It's like, you know, it's like we wanted to have the scene of her enjoying pizza with her sword.
Well, going with what Doc was saying earlier,
she's just
playing a, you know, she's just in the Matrix or something. She decided to log out for a little bit, eat some pizza, kick a ball around, and then go back.
Yeah, I suppose so. That's a good point, actually. Did you guys spend much time in the back door?
No, I didn't.
I spent a decent amount. I went through and I did some of the challenges. I thought some of that was kind of neat.
I did too, until I realized they served no purpose.
Yeah, I did it for a little while, but then some of it was a little bit too easy, and yeah, kind of like you, I mean, I felt like it didn't really give me enough.
Yeah,
I think that was another thing too, is like the idea of like the player choice and the player freedom, that you can kind of like pace yourself, and Jamie said it was too easy, and there are like things you can do to increase the difficulty if you choose to.
Mm-hmm.
And so they're all about like, we're letting the player customize their experience in almost every way, but we also, and of course there
penalize
is...
Penalize yourself.
Yeah, there is developer guidance in the sense that there was a game and it was meant to be at least somewhat challenging, all this different stuff. But it's just like, there's a difference between giving the player choice and meaningful choice and just giving them all the freedom in the world and basically having the infinite shelf problem, mm-hmm. where your choices don't really feel that meaningful anyway. You know, like, if there was a reason for me to go in the back door, I might have done it more, but every time they're like, oh, look, there's another back door, we should go in there. It's like, no, I don't care about that.
Yeah.
You know, I'm just here to do my job, you know, and...
Well, you gotta admit, though, the thing was completely linear,
mm-hmm.
and totally bottlenecked. Mm-hmm. So when you compare it to something like, I don't even know if I want to go there, but the Diablo series,
mm-hmm.
where the level itself is procedurally generated, yeah. The drops, they're procedurally generated, right. and random.
Mm-hmm.
This is a completely different experience, and I'm not one to say that it should have been the other. I'm not saying that at all.
Yeah,
but I still felt like something was missing.
Yeah,
I mean. I wonder, I question, maybe you can actually answer this.
Mm.
Do you get the same power-ups in the same order every time you play? Did you get the same power-ups I got? I don't know. Or was there some kind of element of
you get to
discovery
choose.
To that?
When you level up, yeah, they basically give you a choice between like two or three functions.
Right.
Ah, I remember that. I do remember
so
that.
So technically that's the only real choice.
So on the second playthrough, can you get the other one?
Probably. I mean, because you, on the second playthrough,
you can go back and get some of them too, right?
On the second playthrough, I don't think there's a way to grind, because pretty much, like, there's encounter.
Yeah.
But on the second playthrough, you start with everything that you had at the end of the last one.
Right, I knew that.
So...
But the enemies are harder.
Yeah.
They're a lot harder.
That's true.
It did feel like, to me, that it was a little annoying. I mean, if you don't read the skill very... You know, what'd you call them again? You have the specific...
Functions.
One. Thank you. Function. Mm-hmm. If you don't read the function and you're not really sure what you're getting and you just kind of pick one,
mm-hmm.
Then later you kind of have to build your character around it because,
there's a lot of synergy. Was, like, something else I have kind of, like, a love-hate relationship with, which is world-building through optional text.
Yeah.
I did like the world-building that was in this, and I like...
Call back to our Elder Scrolls.
They actually hinted at this, that... like the ones you know, and basically the functions that you use more, it unlocks more information on them.
Yeah.
So I thought that was kind of a cool like thematic thing, but at the same time, it's like, I don't want everything I know about the world to come through something that I don't have to look at. You know? I need to have, and you know, they probably thought that they were doing enough, and I think ultimately they did do enough to get all the information they need to get across in the course of the main story,
mm-hmm.
with like required quote-unquote content. But I don't know, just there's something about it I'm trying to articulate, and I think maybe I might have hit on a few points.
Yeah.
There's just something about it where like they took... we keep coming back to too far. You know, it's like the list of everything the gamers don't like about linear games, and they say, we're going to fix all these things.
Mm-hmm.
And then it just, there's something that's still missing. You know?
I can kind of see where you'd get that sense from, where it almost feels like running down a checklist of, mm-hmm. it's like trying to make something, you know, based on rules.
Yeah.
It doesn't work. Mm-hmm. You can make something creative based on rules. It never really works.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Like it always feels, you know, too mechanical and kind of and I didn't off excuse me
mm-hmm.
I didn't really get that. I don't know, like it just the I guess lack of emotion is one of the things mm-hmm. that I felt strongly mm-hmm. about in this game. I think it did a lot of things great. It was beautiful.
It didn't
tug
at my heartstrings
visual mm-hmm. but yeah, I felt no emotion, and that was like almost the exact opposite of Bastion.
Yeah,
so I just felt like there was a lot of heart that went into Bastion, and this one it felt just kind of soulless.
Well,
honestly,
you know, I've picked
maybe
on...
hey, it's soulless on purpose because mm-hmm. you're taking people's souls, and
could
you
be.
Lost your soul or
could
whatever.
Be.
no, they did. They weren't that clever.
Oh, okay, you know, I've picked a little bit on Tim Schafer, so I will actually quote him in mm-hmm. something cool that he said one time. He was, I think, it was in 2009, 2010. He was speaking character at GDC. It was on character,
mm-hmm.
and what he said in that particular presentation was, you've got to make the game you're making.
Mm-hmm.
That's one of the about 12 things he said in that presentation that were absolutely brilliant.
Uh-huh.
But if what you're saying is right about the checklist,
mm-hmm.
Then that means they didn't make the game they were making.
Mm-hmm.
And you know, rule number one is always, is the game fun?
Yeah.
And if you're making a game to a checklist mm-hmm. rather than making a game because you've fallen in love with the story you want to tell or the world you want to build or the whatever, mm-hmm. whatever, it makes me wonder
mm-hmm.
if it was emergent as a property of this idea mm-hmm. of let's fix these problems in games.
I honestly would have... I think that it would have worked better as... of course, we've already said it's linear.
Yeah.
But I think it would have worked better if it was just straight up a linear game. If Bastion was like the less linear cousin, like they kind of like took it a different direction with this one.
Mm-hmm.
If it was a less linear game that was like really well crafted, have a great developer narrative, mm-hmm. all that different sort of stuff. And not too concerned with, oh, people won't like it if we like make them pause for 5 seconds to hear a line of dialogue,
mm-hmm.
then I think it could have been a lot better.
Possibly. I mean, you also can yeah. deliver that sometimes without pausing, too. It depends
yeah.
on...
Oh, well, sure. I mean,
so I don't know,
and that part of that problem, too, is that, you know, the character was a mute, and so, you know, in a way, you're kind of conveying your own self onto the character, and we've talked about this before.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And, of course, you got your narrator character who's trying to give you a little bit more context about your background, about
but
the world.
But she didn't show
but...
enough... I honestly don't think she showed enough... None of the characters did. They didn't show enough character
yeah.
to even do that with a
yeah,
mute, because
yeah.
there's mute characters that I think I've really connected with.
Yeah.
I know, like, Chrono is a good example.
Mm.
That I feel like had a character just because he didn't speak doesn't mean he didn't have a character.
Yeah,
Link,
yeah.
a lot of versions of Link, mm-hmm. I feel like has had a character.
Yeah, I felt like they
had
like
character.
A few stabs again with like the fan art thing, a few stabs
yeah.
of trying to give Red a character, yeah. but she didn't really. You know.
I mean, Samus is, I think, another example who
mm-hmm.
has never talked to my knowledge ever.
Mm-hmm.
yeah. I was waiting for
yeah.
to get that.
Yeah, okay.
But yeah, so that's another good example, I think, of a character. She has a character
mm-hmm.
that I think comes through. You know, you're supposed to, all these characters are supposed to have a little bit of this,
mm-hmm.
you know, a better connection with the player because
yeah.
they're not speaking, you can
mm-hmm.
put your own voice in, whatever.
Mm-hmm.
But they still have a character, and you're still role-playing,
yeah.
in a sense.
And not
Red. Red
mm-hmm.
just felt
yeah.
just very, like, soulless mm-hmm. and mechanical.
And I'll reiterate that, as harsh as I might be sounding right now, I thought it was a good experience. I think it's worth playing through if you think you're interested in it.
I think it's worth playing through just to discover what you don't like
mm.
about
yeah, I think
some of the experiment. It was, I
yeah.
think it was an experiment, and I think
yeah.
we as gamers learned a lot from the experiment.
I agree
yeah.
completely. I think it's worth playing for that reason. I
yeah.
completely
yeah.
agree. I don't know if it's worth playing all the way through, so I don't know if I agree
it's
through.
Short enough that I would say play.
But
I would say play.
Just,
yeah.
just don't suck. Just don't, if you're really
because
suffering,
if I
don't hurt yourself.
If I did feel feels at any point during the game, it was at the end. By the end, there was a nice wrap up that I thought was good enough
narratively.
There were some interesting themes of not quite literally.
But there were
some cool themes of, like, for instance, they had the term "gone out to country." It was basically like when a machine goes kaput.
Yeah.
And basically, it looks like what heaven is in this game is a blue sky, golden fields, just like old school barnhouse where life is simple again. It's dark. And that was like one of the last scenes that you see is, you know, at least digitally or in spirit or whatever it was they're trying to imply. Red and Sword Guy, who always went unnamed, you never see his face, are reunited. You know, that's kind of a nice moment.
Mr. Transistor.
Yeah, his name was Transistor, wasn't it?
The Transistor, right?
Yeah, the guy who dresses up like the nuns.
He was wearing black and white.
Yeah.
So, on that note,
full circle.
There's plenty of, there's a lot of Transistor talk, but I do think it was an interesting experience.
Yeah, for sure.
I'm actually really looking forward to the third game. Whatever that might be.
And Supergiant.
Because I'm hoping that Supergiant learns from both of their games and crafts something once again new and experimental and exciting.
Yeah. It was definitely a great effort. If it wasn't, you know, the perfect game, I still think it was... They did a good job. You know, it just... There were some flaws in the execution that I think were just...
I agree.
Design decisions that I didn't like.
Yeah, there were elements, I think that we could safely call them flaws. I don't think it's just an opinionated thing, to be fair. Mm-hmm. But I do also think there were elements of the game that were excellent. Mm-hmm.
Definitely.
You know, like the aesthetic, like the music. So I wouldn't call it a failure of a game, and I do think it's something that people should check out.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Go ahead and play. The sound actually took me back to the early 90s whenever CD-ROMs first came out, and it was a big deal to have voices in games, but they couldn't quite yet afford actors. That idea had not yet come.
Yeah.
In fact, I think it was like Star Trek was one of the first ones that did that. Mm-hmm. But so what you had was developers providing developer acting, which just wasn't that great. Mm-hmm. That's what it reminded me of.
Yeah, I can see that. It was a little jarring for me when I first started hearing some of the voices because I wasn't expecting it to be that bad.
Yeah.
To be honest. A lot of their budget went in other places, I guess.
Clearly, yeah. That's okay.
Oh, they're also indie. So
that's right.
Yeah. Yeah, no, budget's a concern.
Yep.
All right, well, I guess we're about ready to wrap it up.
Yeah, I'd say so.
Yeah. Okay, well, I guess we're going to call it. Thanks for joining us here on the BackwardCompatible.com podcast.
Episode 33.
Yes, episode number 33. Thank you. I'm Jim.
And I'm Chris.
And I am Doc.
See you later.
We need to, like,
buy
you a coffee.
Really?
Or take you out for ice cream or something.
Mm. Why?
Just make sure you're okay.
Bring him down after the B-word incident.
Yeah, I'm fine. Yeah.
we've talked enough Transistor that it's kind of... In fact, if you hadn't brought it up, I think you might have forgotten about it.
Oh, okay, sorry.
Oh, right. Yes, of course.
We'll drive home safely, sir.
He shall not be named.
Right. All right.
You mean the dark lord?
Yes. Yeah. Not everyone.
We want you to join the discussion on our website, backward-compatible.com. You bring a unique perspective, and dialogue makes everyone better. Leave a comment in our podcast section, and if it's good, one of the crew members will respond to it. This time, what do you think about Transistor? What about it would you change or keep the same? Thanks for listening. Until next time, stay compatible.
Backward compatible.